some reflections on a new model for NatureWatch, a little bit of a different talk than the other ones this morning, but what do I do here? Just click the, there we go. So I work for the Victorian National Parks Association. So that is a long-running conservation organization since the early 50s, all about getting areas protected, managed well, getting people out into nature, connecting with nature. So we do a wide range of things. One of the things we do is citizen science projects, and I run the NatureWatch program, which is the land-based. And over there's my colleague, Cade. He runs ReefWatch, the marine-based citizen science, and he's talking on Thursday about this time. So we do a lot of wildlife monitoring, some floral monitoring. We do all sorts of things, responding to threats, specific species, specific areas we want monitoring done in. And projects have gone from 1 year to 10 years. It usually depends on funding. But we have a big element of connecting people to nature, so we want them to understand what we're doing when we're going out to do field work, but also how they can take that information and knowledge home and keep going with it. And more we're moving towards our citizen science projects, supporting our campaign projects to try to protect areas and have better management. So we're moving in that direction. So we've been doing it since 2007. Not me, I've only been doing it for a few years. But we tend to have one-day projects, and they're 1 to 2 hours out of Melbourne. That seems to be the model we've used. But I'm sorry if this is blurry. I'm not sure if it's my eyes or if it is actually blurry. I got new transition lenses, and I don't know how to use them. But after the 2019-2020 Black Summer bushfires, as you know, like, they covered huge areas. And in Victoria, a lot of East Gippsland was burnt, and the hatched areas were burned. The red dots are our field sites, and the blue lines are what we're planning, logging coops. That's changed a little bit, but not totally. So such a massive monitoring effort was needed. I had to kind of rethink the NatureWatch model, and I wasn't quite sure how to deal with it. Many of these sites are 5 to 8 hours from Melbourne. They're remote, some are 2 hours from a local town. So when you're taking teams of volunteers out, you're like, how am I gonna do this well and keep them safe and also get good research done? So had to develop a new model, and we decided to do 3-day expeditions, starting kind of lunchtime on the first day, giving volunteers time to get to a meeting point already out in Gippsland, and then go all day the next day, and then sort of end on lunchtime on the last day. So we needed to have more time to get more things done, but also some flex time if weather changes happened and we needed to adapt on the fly. So I needed volunteers to be a lot more self-sufficient. I couldn't look after them for 3 days. So I had to kind of target things a little bit differently. I had to be very clear as to what their responsibilities on the trip were, and set those expectations really well. And I also just needed more ways to engage people. It's one thing to have them for 4 or 6 hours. It's another to have them for 3 days and have to keep everyone happy. Because when you're remote, if people are unhappy and have to, you know, want to leave, and it can just sort of upset the whole thing. And you're going so far and you've planned so much for this, getting this data collection done, you don't want it to fall over. So on the research areas that we did, I created a new method for us where the research sites were actually 1 kilometer long transects, so that's like trying to be that diagram at the top there. And along that we had 5 points. Each point got a camera, so the Conex wildlife camera. Each point also got a photo point to try to monitor the habitat and the vegetation regrowth after fires and things, and also help describe the site. Point one got an acoustic song meter, so birds, frogs, those kind of things it was going to pick up. And point five got an ultrasonic for bats. We usually split our team into two staff members and usually 4, 6, or 8 volunteers. And we would, one would be working with one staff member doing the cameras as they went along. And the other would be walking that 1 kilometer road or track that the site was on. And we would be doing scat track and other traces surveys to pick up other evidence of animals. Not everyone wants to go in front of camera, so that. And then at night we came back and we did spotlighting along that transect. So we tried to make lots of different things happen, and yeah, it went really well. So in the 2 years of field work, despite COVID, getting in there and canceling a bunch of stuff and changing things and some massive weather events and big storms and floods, We managed to get 13 field expeditions done. So that was 26 kilometers of sites done. 130 cameras out, 52 audio recorders out, 23 kilometers of scats and track traces, and 22 of spotlighting. So a couple of those didn't happen for weather reasons generally. But 85 volunteers. So it was really well supported, which is impressive. There was a lot of work to do. So I'm going to share just some tips that I have for, you know, running this kind of thing that I found work well. So when you're recruiting volunteers, you want to get the right people. So I used quite strong language in my promotion. Luckily, we have a really good database of people who are interested in NatureWatch, and so it wasn't really a problem getting people, but I wanted to get the right people. So I used a lot of words, like really focused on the challenging. Like, it's going to be great, but it's going to be challenging. So, you know, don't commit to this if you think it's not for you. I had them fill in a really detailed application form that really confirmed their ability to do self-sufficient camping. They were, you know, happy in remote areas. They maybe were happy on remote roads, you know, things like that. So that they were being reminded of what was going to be their commitment. Before projects, I would send updates if there was going to be any changes in weather or access issues or things like that, just so they were really prepared and they had another chance to really just think about, do I feel like I can handle this? Am I going to be comfortable? Do I need to bring some extra gear? That kind of thing. Provided really good details on the camping situation, water, things like that, toilet facilities. Some people are just not comfortable with the bush weedy situation, and if you're not comfortable and you're out there for 3 days and that's it, it can be a little bit weird. So I made it really clear what was going to be available. And yeah, really detailed risk assessment, so they really knew what they were getting into. So, and then tips for getting the most out of your field work. I would send a project equipment list and tech list ahead of time, because some people were really into the equipment. Some already had experience, some really wanted to learn them. So they knew about the cameras, they knew the kind of spotlights we used. Some would actually buy them and bring their own, so that was handy. And just the tech list, things like get them to download the Naturalist ahead of time, get that started, and tell them, you know, I use bins and maps and how I use them, because related to that. So just again got them into the idea of what they're going to be doing. Social time to get to know them. Very much that first night when you're camping, everyone sits at camp and they all seem to start far away, but then I try to get everyone to kind of have dinner together, you know, cook your own food and then come in. And that's where you get to learn people's interests and why they're there. And there was a real variety of reasons, which was really interesting, but it allowed me to pick up what their skills were, what their knowledge was, what they really wanted to get out of it. So I was able to then utilize that. And we would have enough people to, if there was bird expert, I'd be like, well, rather than scat survey, do you want to do me a bird survey? Fantastic. Plant survey, insect survey. We had someone who was a spider specialist. Fantastic. Like, really cool. So we got all that extra information, which was really good. Sometimes we had to change our plans last minute. And I always tried to involve the volunteers with that so that we were kind of like, we were working as a team, we were doing it together, so everyone was happy to go along with it. There's a picture there of, that's not my fantasy, but we had one situation where we had to change sites last minute because the access was closed by trees down and things like that, and we didn't have cultural heritage permits for these new sites, so we couldn't bang our stakes that hold our bait stations in front of our cameras in without that, so we had to go, well, what are we going to do? What are we going to put the bait stations on? So we went to Parks Vic Depot and said, can we borrow some bollards? And then we had some bollards, and then we had the big reflective area. I said, well, that's not going to be good in front of the cameras. So we had to kind of, as I said, in the field, MacGyver it a bit, which all the young people went, I don't know what you're talking about. And I'm like, this is what you do in the field. You have to MacGyver it. And they're like, we don't. So I'm like, adapt, you know, use different things. We had garbage bags, tape and all. But we, you know, they enjoyed it. Like, they enjoyed kind of being part of that. It was pretty fun. And then one thing that worked really well is that I did these expedition observation and feedback sheets. So even though we're just doing these 1 kilometer sites, we do two on each expedition, but we're in this area for 3 days. So we had this other like big data sheet that you could just add everything to, whether you saw a redneck wallaby by the toilets, you know, and you went, oh, that's cool, you can write that down. And, you know, I'd encourage people to iNaturalist and figure that out. So we'd actually go through the process in real time, which made them know what was going on, which was really good. But they also, so we got more data through that, but they also provided their feedback on the last morning, so I didn't have to chase them later and go, so what did you think of the trip? And that way you get really interesting quotes because people are kind of like in the moment, they've enjoyed it, they're into it, they're feeling really confident, and you know, so it's a good way to do that and then not have to chase them later, which is great. And then I always had quizzes ready, a little good quiz. We had some games we played, and one night when it was so, the weather was so bad and we were all like clustered in a little shelter, just, you know, thinking, what are we doing here? I just started asking a series of leading questions and people share their stories. So just stuff like, you know, what's your favorite camp site in Victoria? What's your best beach? What's your best hike? And then it got into like, what's your favorite piece of camping gear, like equipment? Some people love the equipment. And then it was like, what's your wish list equipment? And it worked really well because one woman was really coveting someone else's stove and she managed to get that for her anniversary present. So it worked out well. She was pleased. It was great. So getting good data, always about happy volunteers, better field work, better data, fine. So having that variety of methods is great. Some love the cameras, some love the scats. Nobody knew they were going to love the scats till they had to look at scats. Some people were kind of freaked out by it, but as soon as you put the golf ball necklace on them and you go, you are now in charge of this. The picture's a bit squished at the top a little bit, but this is what we use for scale in photos. Just my little quirky thing. So yeah, they had all the information to ID scats as they went and we'd go along with them too. But when we saw something interesting, you get to take the golf ball off, put that next to the scat and you get the photos. For some reason it just made people excited. Plus when you're out in bird forest, you get dirty and you're dirty for days camping and it's a bit, So if people were languishing a little bit in the field, I would suddenly surprise them by having like cat whiskers or like funny faces. So we would use charcoal and do funny faces. Stuff like that just keeps the mood up and it's really quite fun. Teach them and then treat them like equals. I really like that because people are smart. They come on these things, they're smarter than me most of the time. But if you teach them how to do it really well, they will take over it. They will have pride in it. They'll do a really good job. You're still there helping them, but you know, they get really bored if I'm the one just always putting the camera on and they're just sitting there putting the bait station in. So always share that load, which is great. Know when to take a break. People have different levels. You can always find something else for them to be doing while they're waiting for other people to finish other things, but just be aware of that because some people have different energy levels. So how did it go? A few volunteer cancellations, which was great. People felt prepared. They were ready to go for it. They really didn't mind changes. We worked really well. We had two field trips when COVID lockdown was called that night and we had to go, what? So some people left, some people raced out and finished all the data, you know, stuff. So all that kind of thing. Amazingly, no personality clashes or safety concerns. We did have some people who were differently ready for things. So everybody was ready to be self-sufficient, but to some people that meant like full-on, full-wheel drive, excellent setups. I'm in my little camping tent feeling like quite jealous. And then we also had one student who decided he would sleep in his car because he didn't have any camping gear, but he was fine with that. And he thought he was just gonna eat dry instant noodles the whole time. But luckily, other of us, you know, we had enough gear to make sure he was well fed. A lot of mothers on the trip were like, no, you're not eating that. So we worked together really well. Feedback was already done, ticked that off. Everybody, they really enjoyed it. They felt part of it. And so many of them have gone on to do more citizen science projects, either with me or with other ones. And they feedback to me. Sometimes they have to get referrals and things like that. And I'm just amazed at all the amazing projects they've gone out to do. And yeah, they really appreciate when I do a follow-up email and I show them some key photos and the species list from what we found on the sites where they collected the data with me. So that has been a great success and I really enjoyed it. Exhausting stuff, but really good. And I think we made a great contribution to the biodiversity monitoring at Gippsland. And you'll see little cute photos. A greater glider in the photo, that was pretty cool. Never seen caught one of them on photo before, but yeah. That's it.
Thanks, Sera. I was going to ask, do you have a reference, like a science reference group for the methodology?
Yeah, we did. We actually had a community reference group and a science reference group. Yeah, I can talk all about the science end of it.
Yeah.
I just, you know, citizen science.
That's okay. No, yeah. I mean, just someone just to go through the methodology.
Yeah. There was a lot of assessment done to pick the areas we went to and the key species at the times of the year we were going and things like that as well. So we also linked in with other scientists, the government recovery programs, and some of the local groups.
Okay. Yeah. Any questions for Sera? People can smell the food up the back and
yeah.
It's getting a bit hungry now.
Time.
Hi there, thank you for that. That was a lot to unpack. That was very exciting. My question is in regards to TURN and the TURN 24 protocols and comparability of results and utilisation through science for hysterosity and whatever else you guys get up to. So
yeah.
Just wondering if, I guess it's not so much a question, but if you have anything to say on that, please.
So in terms of how our data leads into everything else, it's definitely something I've been advancing in the NatureWatch program. So I took over 5 years ago, and it was, there's sort of limitations to the data that we collect. A lot of it is presence, absence sort of stuff, but a lot of the time that's enough, particularly when you're looking at threatened species and areas where there's been a big impact and to try to find out if they are persisting, but also in areas where there's going to be a planned impact. So we also did logging coop areas and things like that. So while the data is not heavily comparative in some ways, it is the presence absence. I think it does feed into some of the more immediate management decisions. So in some sites, we had greater gliders on spotlighting, and we had specifically picked areas, like one site literally went between two kind of logging coops in a really remote area that just did not need to be logging. It was fabulous and beautiful, it's just great. And we managed to stop those logging coops because we were able to record them properly. So it's sort of that kind of conservation outcome we're going for. Yeah, did that answer it?